Hello. Today we shall study the remaining fancy yarns. We have studied a few types of basic fancy yarns in the first part of the lecture. So today we shall go ahead and see the others. So the first yarn that we are going to study is the slub yarn. Slubs, as we know, they are thick places in the yarn. A slub yarn is one in which slubs have been deliberately created to produce the desired discontinuity of effect. We have already discussed this in the sense that fancy yarns are actually deliberately made with defects. In a normal yarn, a slub would be treated like a defect and be removed. But in case of a fancy yarn, slubs are introduced so that you get attractive look to the fabric that is made out of it. So this is an example of ground slub yarn. Let us see the various types of slub yarn that time during that time this ground slub yarn term will become very clear. They can take the form of a very very gradual change with only a slight thickening of the yarn at its thickest point. Alternatively, the slub may be 3 or 4 times the thickness of the base yarn, and that thickness may be achieved within a very short length of yarn. So you can have different types or different lengths and dimensions of this slub in your yarn. The slub was first developed in an attempt to produce a linen look using cotton yarns. So initially it was made to give the look of a linen fabric. We all know what a linen fabric looks like. I think there is an image of a shirt here, yes. So this is how a linen fabric would look, and the look of it, to produce that kind of look in the fabric using cotton fibers, that is what was an attempt when the first slub yarn was developed. So this is the image of a actual slub yarn. So let us see what are the various varieties of slubs. The slubs are used both in knitted as well as woven fabrics. We can see in knitted fabrics how this is used. To a plain knitted garment, it gives a very different attractive look. Some kind of interest is generated where you can use slubs. The finer slub can be used simply to introduce a subtle but pleasing variation in the surface appearance of a plain fabric, and are used often for this purpose in both upholstery as well as apparel fabrics. On the other hand, the heavier slub effect produces stronger variations in the fabric surface and can become a design element in itself. So a fine slub would where it would create a subtle pleasing variation, a heavier slub can be used to give a stronger variation in the fabric, and it can become a part of the design itself. The slub effect can be produced by a variety of means, each offering its own benefits and challenges. So let us go ahead and see the various methods to produce slub yarns. A variety of methods are available for producing slub yarns, and the resulting yarns may be divided into following classes. Slub yarn produced at the spinning frame are known as spun slubs. They can be produced by blending fibers of different dimensions. Now we all know that in a drafting system, whenever there is a drafting wave, that is when a thick or thin place is created or a slub is created. That means the fibers are not being guided properly in the drafting system, and that leads to variations. It basically means that if there are short fibers or there are floating fibers that are there in the material that is being processed, then we are likely to get slubs. So now, since we are going to deliberately produce slubs here, we are blending fibers of different dimensions. So for example, here it could be woolen slubbing with worsted top sliver, where worsted would be a combed sliver, and along with that, if we are able to say blend in woolen slubs, woolen slubbing or woolen sliver as it is known as, then we might create that slub formation, that atmosphere or the environment in which this particular slub will be generated. The imperfect fiber control during drafting produces randomly distributed slubs of varying sizes. It is required to produce a sliver or roving that blends these differing fibers. So to get this different dimensions, we may have to prepare the sliver accordingly and have both these types of slivers together and prepare a sliver or roving that with this kind of blend. The drafting aprons may also be removed, and the resulting uneven movement of the fibers can be exploited to create deliberately introduce random variations in the yarn. So another way of doing this would be remove the aprons entirely, because aprons are responsible for guiding the fibers to the next ruler nip, and if we were to remove them, they would again lead to the formation of slubs. So the second way of introducing slubs in the yarn is by plucked or inserted slub yarns, as they are known as, are composed of two foundation threads and periodic short lengths of roving composed of straight twistless fibers that have been plucked by the roller action. So what is done is basically we are introducing roving also along with two foundation threads over here, and small parts of roving is being plucked by the roller action. This method tends to give a neater, cleaner appearance than that is achieved in producing spun slubs. So this will give you a much neater appearance because you are having a better control over the roving that is being plucked by this particular roller action. Coming to the third alternative method of producing slubs is to modify the spinning frame such that the intermittent acceleration of the rollers causes varying degree of draft to be applied. So if you have an intermittent acceleration and deacceleration of the rollers, then in that case we have high draft and low draft one after the other, and accordingly we will be able to create a thick and thin place, and ultimately in the production of a slub yarn. In this case, it is relatively fine yarn with a fine and fairly long slub. This produces ground slub. So the image that we saw in the earlier slide, ground slub means we are taking the same material and forming slubs from it by using varying degrees of draft. These are slubs that have the same fiber composition as the yarn, and it can be seen that this is formed of a single structure. No additional yarn or process has been involved in creating this yarn. This method might also be used on the fly frame to produce a slub roving from which a yarn could be spun using constant draft. What we can do is we can have this acceleration and deacceleration instead of ring frame on the flyer, and whatever roving we get, thick and thin, that introduced roving which is thick and thin along its length, could then be drafted on the ring frame, and we could get a slub yarn. But the yarn created in this way would have very long slubs because it would get drafted on the ring frame, and whatever thick place was created at the fly frame would become longer, and we will have very long slubs that become apparent only gradually in the fabric. So these are various methods. Let us go to the next method. Such a yarn, that is ground slub yarn, is very simple, easy to understand and straightforward to set up, but can prove to be problematic in use since the slubs take very little twist and become weak spots in the yarn. One thing that one must keep in mind is that whenever ground slubs are made, the twist does not reach the thick places. As we know, the twist flows into the thinnest part in the yarn as it is flowing. So since the moment it encounters a thick place, it will stop there, and twist will not be introduced in these areas, and they will remain weak, and such weak spots are going to be a problem in the final yarn. So the thick place in the yarn is followed immediately by a thin place rather than by a simple return to the basic yarn count, because we are using the same material in accelerating and deaccelerating the rollers for draft, and that is why a thick place will generally be followed by a thin place, and this thin place would not be the normal count that was originally spun. So therefore, this also creates a weak place in the yarn, and the slub yarn needs very careful balancing of feed and delivery speeds in order to avoid the production of yarns too weak for processing. So we come to the next method of production of slubs. A further method would lie in the injection of additional material into the front drafting zone. The setting must be varied over a very long repeat to avoid patterning of the material. That means we should also see to it that if the slubs appear at the same distance and frequency, then it might lead to a formation of a pattern in the fabric also. So it should be taken care of. This method allows the production of flake or flamme yarns, which are very long slubs. Slubs may have a different fiber composition to that of the ground yarn. Now here, what one can do is we can introduce different materials into the system, where the slubs can have a different fiber composition to the ground yarn. So this is a major difference between ground slub and this method of production of slubs. Injected slub yarns can be made, however, with the plying process. In this case, roving replaces a yarn as a profile component, and the rollers feeding the roving periodically stop and start according to the required slub length and spacing. So the roller would stop and start introducing this this material, whichever we are intending to inject for the formation of the slub. The slub thickness is determined by the roving count. Whatever roving count we are going to use, that will determine the slub thickness. So this is how the yarn would look like. This is the loosely twisted thick spot. This material is coming from the roving that we have introduced, and this is the foundation or the core yarn that is holding onto the slub. As an example, we can say that a 600 tex roving, that means a thick roving of 1.7 dtex acrylic fibers, may be fed without overfeed onto a 2x30 tex ground yarn made from the same fiber. We can have the same fiber or a different fiber depending on our choice. But here, as an example, they have taken same fiber but they are dyed in a different color. The slub lengths formed by periodic stopping of the roving feed would be twisted with the ground yarn using 650 twist per meter. The opposite twist direction to that of the ground, that is a ply twist, is used, as this would enable the slub to be better embedded. So one more twisting operation is done so that the slub will be embedded better between the ground yarns. And for the second twisting, a single 34 tex acrylic yarn may be applied as a binder with a twist level of 250 turns per meter. So this is just one example. We can have many kind of slubs. This was just an idea as to understand how this particular slub yarn could be made. We can have a variety of slub yarns by changing the material, the length of the slub, the frequency of the slub, and the twist, and so on. So we shall go to the next way of producing the slub yarns. Slubs can also be produced by adjusting the card setting. So slub yarns can be actually produced as early as the card, where we can have so that the fiber stock is rolled to form neps or slubs. This is simply the opposite of the normal carding action. So in a normal carding action, we would want to remove the slubs or neps, but in this case we are trying to introduce. Therefore, it is possible to produce slubs by varying either the cylinder or a doffer setting or the doffer speed. However, we should understand that this technique is rarely employed because it is very difficult and therefore time consuming to alter the speeds of these large cylinders. A better yarn can be produced by using fibers that have good cohesion between them. So this method is there, but it is hardly used. A flake yarn can be produced at the condenser of woolen card. So in the case of a woolen card, at the condenser level, introduction of random lengths of effects slivers or flakes, we can have this kind of a flake yarn. So it is introduced into the condenser calendar roller or on the condenser doffer. These slivers are prepared separately on another card. The flakes should not be too thick compared with the ground yarn, otherwise it will be difficult to spin and wind the yarn. So then we come to the next way of producing slub yarns, and we come to the system of rotor spinning or open end spinning, where we can get slub yarns. Recent developments in open end spinning used for short staple fiber spinning have made it possible to create rotor spun slub yarns. These yarns may be used in furnishing and drapes, and they are not used in apparels as such. Although they are sometimes used in denim, because whatever yarn count is produced on rotor spinning, we know that it is going to be a coarse count. They are produced by attachments to ordinary open-end spinning devices, which usually incorporate an electronically controlled device to briefly accelerate the drawing-in roller. So the drawing-in roller is accelerated briefly at certain times so as to introduce the slubs. As a result of the back doubling action inside the rotor, it is not possible to produce slubs shorter than the circumferential length of the rotor, because any variation in the fiber feedstock is spread over a minimum length of the rotor circumference. We know that in the rotor, whenever we go for this kind of spinning, in the rotor there is a phenomenon known as back doubling, which will even out whatever unevenness is being introduced. So even if we have introduced some kind of variation by accelerating the drawing in roller, which is going to take in the slivers into the machine, in spite of that variation that is introduced, it might get evened out to the extent of the circumferential length of the rotor, because here it happens because of the back doubling action, and therefore slub length that is shorter than the circumferential length of the rotor might be difficult to produce here. And there have also been attempts to use injections of pressurized air into the fiber transportation tube to alter the fiber flow and thus introduce variations in the yarn. However, the effects created using this approach are very limited, since the fiber flow in the transportation tube is extremely thin. We know that very few fibers are being transported through the transportation tube, and even if we were to create some kind of a disturbance or some kind of atmosphere to see to it that we create a variation here, it would be a very, very small variation, and the variation in the yarn caused by changes in the airflow is consequently very, very small to the extent that we would probably want the slub yarn to have. So coming to the next method of producing of slubs, we can also use the friction spinning. Slub yarns which are potentially important for decorative effects can be produced on the friction system by changing the feed speed of one or more of the slivers, or by injecting fibers directly into the friction zone. However, the yarns tend to offer low performance in processing and use as a result of poor binding of the fibers in the yarn indicated earlier. So here, injecting of the fibers directly into the perforated roller nib can be the source for the production of slubs. But we should know here that as it is, we know that drifts spinning or the friction spinning system would lead to very low strength yarns. And there, because of the poor binding of the fibers in the yarn, which would normally be there otherwise also during the production of a normal yarn, we should remember that this kind of production of slub yarns might lead to poor strength or binding in the fibers in the yarn. So now we come to the next system. Even the hollow spindle system that we have already learned may also be used to produce a slub effects. So let us see how it is done. A sliver or roving can be fed to the nip of the front drafting rollers. The injection unit consists of a pair of roller driven aprons which guide the sliver or roving into the front drafting zone of the main effect component just behind the front rollers. So here the roving is introduced just before the front rollers. The control system is programmed to stop the aprons when the front rollers nip the injected fibers, with the result that fiber tufts are pulled into the main effect component and spun into the final yarn. So here also there is some kind of plucking system which will take this particular roving that is being fed just before the front drafting zone, and it can lead to the production of slub yarns. So we have seen in spinning whatever possible ways of production of slub yarns. But there's one more method at the weaving stage in jacquards, where it is possible to produce an appearance that resembles some of the effects produced by incorporating slub yarn in the woven fabric without the expense of material incurred by the use of the yarn themselves. That means that instead of using the yarn slub yarns, we can make some changes at the weaving stage so as to create an effect similar to that given by the slub yarns. The skilled programming of a jacquard controlled weaving machine makes it possible to mimic the appearance of slub in the weft using ordinary straight yarns. Here, of course, the expenses will be there in case of purchasing. Whatever expense we would have incurred in purchasing of the slab yarn would have been spent on the purchase of the advanced weaving machine and its programming. So somewhere it might balance the costs or the expense that is involved. But this is one more method of introducing or mimic the slab-like effect into the fabric. So we have seen all the various methods of producing of slab yarns. We have also seen its structure. Now let us come to the next type of fancy yarn, that is the knop yarn. And this is how the knop yarn looks like when woven into the fabric. A knop yarn is one that contains prominent bunches of one or more of its component threads arranged at regular or irregular intervals along its length. So the first look at the particular yarn would seem that it is similar to the slab yarn, but it is slightly different in the structure. Let us see how this structure looks is made, and then maybe we will be able to discuss or compare these two particular yarns. The insertion of twist gathers the knopping thread into a bunch or a knop. The figure here shows two simple knop yarns in widely differing counts. We can see here they are two different knop yarns, but the counts are widely differing. Both demonstrate the somewhat slub-like effect of the yarn, but in both examples it is clear that the knop is made by coiled yarns rather than being a fibrous mass like a slub. So this is a major difference between a knop and a slub yarn, that in case of a knop yarn, it is produced, this particular thickness is being produced with the use of a separate yarn or a effect yarn rather than the fibers themselves. In the case of all the methods that we have seen earlier in the production of slub yarns, what is done is the fibers are forming this particular thick place or a slub, whereas here it is the yarn that is forming the thick place. This is the major difference. So having understood that, let us see what are the different kinds of knop yarns that are available. Superfine long knop yarns are used often to produce a lost and found. This is a name given to the particular effect in the fabric, in the pinstripe in fine suitings. It is called as lost and found, where sometimes the knop will be colored differently from the rest of the yarn, producing an occasional flash of color in an otherwise plain fabric. So just to create some interest, where otherwise it would be a plain fabric, some sort of occasional flash of color is introduced using this kind of knop yarns. So the yarn is yarn to be somewhat heavier than the slab yarn and is easier to make. This knop yarn is easier to produce. We shall see that shortly. Knop yarn is used to introduce an effect similar in outward appearance to that of a slab, except that the effect is created of yarn rather than from the fiber and is therefore somewhat stiffer and harder in feel. Another major difference between a slab and a knop yarn is that the slab yarn would be softer in feel because it is made out of fibers, whereas knop yarns, which is made with the help of another effect yarn, it will be stiffer and harder in feel. So let us see the production of knop yarns. Two pairs of rulers, each capable of being operated independently, will be needed here because we need to produce bunches of yarn, and one of the yarns will have to slow down while the other yarn wraps itself around the previous one in the form of bunches. So we will require two pairs of rollers. This makes it possible to deliver the foundation threads intermittently, while the knopping thread that create the effect are delivered continuously. So knopping thread or the effect thread that is there, it will be delivered continuously, and moment the foundation thread is stopped or run slowly, the knopping thread would wrap itself around the foundation yarn. The knopping thread joins the foundation thread below the knopping bar. We'll see what this knopping bar is there in the next slide. The insertion of a twist gathers the knopping threads into a bunch or knob. The vertical movement of the knopping bars determines whether the knob is small and compact or spread out along some length of the yarn. So this knopping bar, which we shall see shortly, is responsible for the size of the knob, whether the knob will be spread out or it will be compact, and the bunching will happen in a concentrated manner at one place. It is decided by the movement of this particular knopping bar, and the foundation and the knopping threads generally meet just below the knopping bar. So this is the diagram, and we can see this is the knobbing bar or the control bar. What we see here is that the effect yarn as usual is controlled by the front pair of rollers, whereas the ground yarns are coming from the back rollers and they are passing through the grooves on the front top roller, so that they are controlled by the back rollers only, just like before. And we can see that the ground and the effect yarn are meeting just below the knobbing bar here. This is also known as control bar. And the movement of this control bar in the upward and downward direction will decide the size of the knob that is being produced. So the ground yarn needs to be fed intermittently. The effect yarn and the ground yarn converge below the knobbing bar. As we have seen here, the ground yarn would have an intermittent feeding motion over here, because of which this knobbing can take place. The knob effect is formed when the ground yarn stops while the effect yarn continues to be fed, forming a prominent bunch on the yarn surface. To achieve a neat knob, the control bar remains stationary. If you want a neat knob, very prominent kind of knob, in that case the knobbing bar would be stationary, so that the effect yarn is given as little play as possible. That means the effect yarn would not be spread out on the ground yarn. During the formation of the knob, the control bar can be moved up and down to spread the knob over a desired length of the yarn. This produces an elongated knob, which creates an effect often referred to as a stripe yarn. These stripes may be fixed by using a high twist level, or may be left floating by using a low twist level. So the twist level will decide whether whether the knobs would be able to slide themselves over the foundation yarn or not. In the latter case, the stripes will then move up and down the yarn during subsequent processes. If they are twisted with using a low twist level, then there's a possibility that these knobs, which are loosely bound, will have an opportunity to move or slide on the foundation yarn during subsequent processing. Two effect yarns of different colors may also be used to wrap around each other alternately. So we can, instead of having a ground and effect, we can say that we can call both of them as an effect yarn, and they are running alternately. That means intermittent running and stopping is happening. In which case there will be none of the yarn would be termed as a ground yarn. And what we can do is we can have two different colors for these two effect yarns, and alternately each one of them forms the knob. So in this case, no ground yarn is used, since each yarn in turn takes the place of the ground yarn. The knobs of one yarn hide the color of the other yarn alternately, which produces an effect. Now this effect would be similar in looks to the space dyeing effect, where yarn is dyed intermittently using different colors. So we can have this kind of similar effect with the use of knobbing effect yarns of different colors. So this is the kind of fabric that might be created. Some Italian worsted suiting use superfine marls. We know what are marls, marl yarns, and the knob yarns to inject life and color into an otherwise plain fabric. So a plain fabric would look more interesting by the introduction of marls, marl and knob yarns. These are now so fine that no significant change in level can be felt between the plain fabric and the knob. But the flash of color produces an intermittent pinstripe effect, which adds interest to the fabric. Yarns that are used may include marls or even ombre yarns. These yarns are yarns that gradually change from light to dark color. So such yarns may also be used. Dyed yarns to give intermittent stripes may be used, or extra fine knob yarns to give the same effect. So these are the various methods or ways in which one can create an interesting feature, texture or look in the final fabric. So a designer has all these options from which he can choose and create these effects. So coming to the next kind of yarn, that is the cover yarn. A cover yarn is one in which a yarn at the core is completely covered by the fiber or yarn wrapped around it. So it is familiar to the embroiderers. It is very common with embroiderers, because they use this metallic embroidery threads which take the form of a filament is basically there at the core, and there is a metallic thread or a flat ribbon which completely wraps the filament and this kind of a yarn is mainly used in embroidery. And this was, as indeed has been in the case for several thousands of years. Now this has been there in existence for thousands of years. The Romans used to use gold threads made in this way. The method is most commonly used to cover elastomeric yarns. Nowadays, this kind of method is used to make elastomeric yarns, which would otherwise be extremely uncomfortable to wear. So, to introduce a stretch, but at the same time introduce a good comfortable feel, cover the elastomeric yarns are covered with another yarn so as to create that comfort. So these are the two ways or the two structures of covered cover yarns. So this is the conventional covered yarn where this is the material inside is spandex, which is stretchable, and this is the elastomeric yarn. And on this, since it would be uncomfortable if it were to be left as it is, we may have one more layer of covering with this particular yarn, which will completely cover the spandex yarn in the at the core. And we can have a single cover or maybe even a double cover. We can have one more another yarn covering the entire structure over here. So single covered yarn taking a single layer of spandex covered filament, or we can have a double covered yarn taking two layers of spandex covered filament. Another way of producing this kind of cover yarns is by air jet. This will become very clear when we know texturizing in the background. In case of texturizing, we use air jet method to produce textured yarns. This is similar to that. Air covered yarns, that is, it is known as, or it is also known as intermingled yarn. In this case, at the core, the spandex is there, and other filament, whichever we require for covering, would be there in this manner. Air covered yarn is covered by multi filament artificial yarn by using air jets. It can only be used filament, but is not suitable for spun yarns. So only filaments are used here. It will not be suitable for any kind of spun yarns to produce this kind of an intermingled covered yarn. So there is another this conventional method how this cover yarns are made. Cover yarns are made by the plying process. The same method is same passage is used. The threading arrangement is identical to the knob where the two pair rollers controlling the yarn are made to stop and start as required. However, instead of stopping each pair of rollers, it will in turn slow down to a speed that allows the other yarn to wrap around that fed by the slowed rollers. So instead of, there is no stopping here because we do not need bunches anymore. We want one yarn to cover the other. So there will be a continuous feed of ground as well as the effect, but the ground yarn would be slower moving, whereas the effect yarn would be faster moving. And so the effect yarn will have an opportunity to wrap itself around the ground yarns continuously. The wrapping coils bunch closely to completely cover the length of the slowly moving yarn. So this is how it is produced using the same passage as earlier. The level of twist required is usually high, of the order of 1600 turns per meter. This wrapping action may be made to alternate between two yarns which are of different colors. Again, we can have two effect yarn, two passages which we can have different color effects. The resulting fancy yarn would have alternating sections of colors. The length of each colored section should vary so as to avoid patterning defects in the end fabric. Again, we must take care that the colors are put in or introduced in such a way that we avoid patterning defects in the final fabric where they might tend to come together and form color patches. So we come to the next kind of yarn, that is the chenille yarns. Chenille is French for caterpillar. Caterpillar in French is called as chenille, and the yarn looks somewhat like this caterpillar which is shown here, and that is why the name chenille yarns. So this is how the yarn looks like, almost similar to this particular caterpillar here. And this is the look of the fabric that is finally made out of such yarns. So structure of chenille yarns is like this. The basic structure of the chenille yarn consists of a cut pile, which may be made of a variety of fabrics helically disposed around the two axial threads that secure it. So there are two ground threads, and we can see that there are threads which are perpendicular to the structure, and they look like cut piles here. and this is how a chenille yarn looks. And if we go further and look at the analysis of it, if we were to twist the ground, untwist the ground or the foundation threads, we would get such short lengths of yarn that are coming out of the structure, as we can imagine. So with this background, let us see the various methods of producing the chenille yarns. The chenille machine is less versatile and can only produce a single structure. Now, chenille yarns cannot be produced in the whatever machines that we have already seen. We need a separate machine for this, and therefore this machine is less versatile because it can only produce chenille yarns, and it can produce only this kind of a single structure. It is unique since it can produce a chenille yarn rapidly. One advantage is that it will produce this very fast, consistently, and at a low cost than previously was feasible. The yarn does not have a very good inherent abrasion resistance. As we have seen the structure, the yarn as it is might not have a good abrasion resistance, but it will give a very nice, interesting look to the fabric that is produced from it. In later treatment of the yarn, the number of winding processes need to be carefully monitored in order to ensure that the nap lies in the same direction. Now, what we mean by nap is that this particular threads that are coming out of the structure of the yarn, they tend to lie in a particular direction. If pressure was applied onto this, they will just fall off in the horizontal direction like this, and this is known as a nap. So, and this will happen normally during winding or subsequent processes of chenille yarn production. As soon as you wind it, these particular fibers may try to lie in one particular direction on all cones or cheeses in a batch. If it is not monitored properly, then what happens is the fabric in which the yarn is used will show color differences, and that is because of resulting from the differing reflectance of the nap. The nap which would be lying in different directions would reflect color in a different way, and because of such reflectance, there might be a difference in color that would be appearing in the fabric. Now, because it depends on the angle of the pile and of the light, so this we must monitor the winding process very carefully. Chenille yarns may be produced by any one of the following methods. First one is weaving, and the second is the chenille system itself. Third is flocking, and the fourth is a mock chenille. So one by one we'll see all of them. Chenille by weaving, it is produced by cutting a woven lino fabric into narrow warp wise strips. We know this is the lino fabric that is made, normally made for mosquito nets or any other applications. So this particular fabric can then be, the projecting tufts are formed by the weft of the original lino fabric. What is done is they are cut here and in between these columns of lino whatever threads, lino threads are there. So the moment you cut this, this warp would form the core yarn, whereas the weft will form the threads that are projecting in a perpendicular direction from the structure of the yarn. So this is how it will be formed. The moment you cut this strip, you will get a chenille yarn like this. So this is your basic core yarn, which is made up of the warp that is woven in a lino loom. This method is slow and hence not a great alternative for a general market. So this method being slow, it will not be feasible to use this for a general market. So we have this chenille system. This system produces two yarns at a time. We'll see how. So this is the diagram or the image of the machine, it is used to produce this chenille yarns. The effect yarns are wrapped. Now this is the effect yarn which is wrapped around a gauge. This is the gauge, it is also known as a former. That is, you can see that it is triangularly shaped at the top and narrows towards the base. Now the effect yarn is going to coil and slide downwards like this. Because it is shaped in a triangular manner, it will tend to slide slowly downwards. And here you can see there is a knife, there is a cutting knife. This cutting knife will, as it is sliding, it will cut these threads on both the sides. And you will get short lengths of yarn like this, which are coming out from this area. So one set of this kind of yarns would be pattern would be coming out over here, and there would be another set of yarns that are coming from the other side. So you will basically get two sets of such threads that are cut and which are coming out. So the effect yarn will slide downwards onto the cutting knife. So this is the cutting knife. The width at the bottom of the gauge determines the effect length. As we can easily understand that whatever width is there over here at the bottommost portion of this particular gauge, that would be the length of the effect yarn that is going to project out of the yarn structure. If this is wider, you will get a longer pile over here. So by maintaining the depth of the pile or beard in the final yarn, so this will decide the depth of the pile. The knife here, although here straight knife is shown, it can also be a circular kind of knife which will be continuously cutting. So we can have a circular knife instead over here. So here we come to the how the ground yarn is fed now. Now once this particular strip is produced, now there needs to be something to bind this. And what is done is on either side, there is a set of rollers like this, take-up roller and companion roller. Which will have a space here in between through which the yarn will pass through. So we shall see shortly. Both these, there are two sets of rollers like this. That means four rollers on two on one side, two on the other. So we will have to look at the other angle of this particular image here, which will be shown on the next slide. So it is like this, where the knife is shown now from another angle. This is the effect yarn which has been wound on the gauge, and this is your cutting knife from the bottom here, and this is the side view now. And on either side there will be this two sets of rollers, one known as the take-up roller and the companion roller over here. And let us see how this works now. So the whatever cut yarns have come out from the knife after cutting, they are trapped in between this ground yarn which is coming over the take-up roller. One yarn is coming from the top above these particular cut yarns or the piles, and the second yarn is ground yarn is coming from the bottom, and it is holding the cut piles from below. And then they will be forming, they will, the cut piles are trapped in between these two ground yarns, and we get a chenille yarn. On each side of the cutting knife, there are two ground yarns, which may be either single or two-fold yarns. We can have a single or a two-fold yarn for ground yarns. It would be our choice. One ground yarn is guided by the take-up roller, that is from the top it is coming, while the other is guided by the companion roller, which is coming from the bottom. The take-up roller is pressed against the profile guide and intermeshes with the companion roller. So this will be pressing against this profile of this particular guide over here. And it will also at the same time intermesh with the companion roller that is there, allowing the two ground yarns to trap the pile created by the effect yarn in between them at right angles to the ground yarn axis. So it will be trapped, and these two ground yarn are then twisted together, since there is a twisting which is happening after this. So the twist is introduced, and automatically this ground yarn will trap all these cut effect yarn that has come out from this particular region. So the two ground yarns are twisted together usually by a ring spindle at the lower part of the machine to produce the final yarn. So as you can see, the first statement that was said that this particular machine will produce two yarns at the same time, one on the right hand side and the other on the left hand side. So two yarns are simultaneously produced, so the production rates are very high. So coming to the next method of producing the chenille yarn would be flocking. Chenille effects can also be produced by the flocking process. Components of flocked yarn are the flock, the a carrier yarn, and a layer of adhesive material. A ground yarn, that is the core yarn or the ground yarn, is coated with an adhesive, that is the glue that is shown here, and is flocked electrostatically with loose fibers. So loose fibers are made to fall on this particular glue and stick to the core yarn. So the loose fibers and the ground yarn are charged with opposite electrostatic charges. So the ground yarn would have a different opposite charge as compared to the flock that is being introduced. As a result of this, the loose fibers are attracted to the ground yarn. Since they are oppositely charged, they would be attracted to each other and are bonded to it by the adhesive. At the same time, all the loose fibers have the same electrostatic charge. So another point to note is that all the flock that has come here will have the same charge on it, and therefore they will repel each other and they will not be attracted and form bunches over here. So they will be separately directed towards the chorion. And because of this, they will repel each other, ensuring good fiber separation and also forcing them to stand on the ground yarn rather than lie flat on the ground yarn surface. If these fibers were to have different charges, they would attract and they would lie flat. But to our advantage, since the flock is all similarly charged, they would lie straight and have a good fiber separation. This is a very economical production method. But the major disadvantage, we know that the yarn has a poor abrasion resistance because the anchor of the loose fibers onto the ground yarn is very small. Since the flock is just held on to the ground yarn with the help of one point or because of the glue here, the abrasion resistance would be very poor. And these loose fibers can very easily be worn off, leaving the ground yarn bare. Easily this may come off and the ground yarn would be looking bare over here, and it would give a very shabby appearance to the fabric. Flocked yarns have a velvet appearance with a soft touch, high comfort, excellent moisture management, and is able to absorb and reduce friction. So the main application of this kind of flocked yarn is in the automotive market. Textiles woven with flocked yarns are used as covers of car seats, also electrical movements of internal parts of the car wherever they are there, like seats or sunroofs are managed by flexible shafts, where flocked yarn is applied for silencing purposes. So flocked yarn has got its own application in case of automotive market. So we go to the next type of yarn, which is a mock chenille. Although this is not an the structure would not be looking like an original chenille, but it can be, you know, passed off as a chenille. So it is therefore the name mock chenille. A mock chenille effect can be produced by plying two jimp or boucle or loop yarns. We have already learnt jimp, boucle and loop yarns in our earlier lectures. So these yarns could then be used or plied together to give that mock chenille effect, which will give a denser effect. For example, two loop yarns with large number of small loops can be used and they plied together to give this mock chenille effect. The yarn may not look like a chenille. So the yarn itself does not look like a chenille, but when it is made into a fabric, the large number of small loops that are there in the fabric, because when we are applying, we are creating a high density of loops. These small loops will result in the fabric surface that resembles a chenille effect. It will seem much harsher in handle. Of course, it will be much harsh in handle because it does not involve cutting the loops. We are not having cut piles here. We are going to have loops instead. And so it will be much harsher, which does not involve cutting off loops of the effect yarn. And so it lacks the velvety feel. It is made by doubling a corkscrew or a jimp yarn. It is made by doubling together two or more unbalanced corkscrew or jimp yarns in the reverse direction with sufficient twist to form a balanced structure. What we can do is only the plying twist, we can put it in the opposite direction so as to make it as a balanced structure. The look would not be just like the original chenille, but still in the fabric it will seem to be similar. So with this chenille yarns, we have completed all the basic types of yarns that we had seen in the first chart, basic profile structures. And so with this, we come to the end of this lecture. Thank you.